Hello students, very good morning to all. So students, this is the second video lecture of this chapter, physical and chemical changes. Now in previous lecture or previous you can say discussion, we have seen few things. So let me discuss quickly what we have discussed in the previous lecture. In the previous lecture students, we have seen few you can say activities regarding physical changes. Then we have discussed what are the results or end products of these activities. Then we have discussed what are the properties of physical changes. Then we will discuss chemical change with this activity. We have discussed this activity that if we burn a ribbon of magnesium in open air, then what will happen? It will create magnesium oxide. And if we add some water in that magnesium oxide solution, then it will create magnesium hydroxide. Okay. Now let us discuss one more activity. Definitely this is chemical change students, we will discuss the properties after this activity. So this is activity 8.7. What we have to do, take a glass beaker half filled with water, dissolve about a teaspoon of copper sulfate into it. Okay, so first of all we just take a glass half full of water and we have to add copper sulfate solution. Okay, now you will get a blue solution. Now students, copper sulfate, you can say CuSO4, it is the, you can say, chemical formula of copper sulfate, CuSO4. Now it is blue itself, so when we put this solution into water, so the whole solution turns into blue. Okay, because copper sulfate itself is a blue color substance. Okay, now drop an iron nail into the beaker. What we have to do, we drop an iron nail. Iron means Fe, we have already discussed. Now wait for an hour and observe the color of the solution and the iron nail in the beaker. Is there any change in color of the solution in the beaker? Also observe if iron nail changed in any way. You can see students that first of all the solution is blue color. You can see here after 1 hour the solution will turn into green color. Now why this green color is there? Okay. You can see here this is the formula. Okay. We will discuss that what will happen, that when an iron nail is placed in the copper sulfate solution, what will happen? A new substance called iron sulfate is formed. Okay, so you can see here this is the iron sulfate FeSO4 and this is green in color. That's why the whole solution turns into green. Okay, and the color of the solution changes from blue to green. Now copper gets deposited in the iron nail. Okay, this change can be represented by a chemical equation. So this is the chemical equation. When copper sulfate, that means CuSO4, reacts with iron, then we will get, you can say, iron sulfate, that means FeSO4 plus copper. The copper will turn into reddish brown color. Okay, so that's why the change is taken place. Now students, these activities are under chemical changes, but these activities or these experiments are very important for your exam purpose also. Question will come in this way, that what will happen when we mix copper sulfate or when we put a iron nail into copper sulfate solution, what will happen? Then you have to explain that we have to wait after, you can say, putting the iron nail, then the solution turns into green in color. And why this green color changes, you have to explain from this, that their iron sulfate, a new substance iron sulfate will be formed and it is green in color. That's why the whole solution changes into green color. Okay. So I hope this is clear. So what we have to do students, you have to read these reactions very properly with this chemical formula. Okay. Chemical equation is very much important. Now let us discuss one more activity. We call it as activity 8.8. So this activity tells that take some vinegar in a test tube. What we have to do, we have to take some vinegar. Now add a pinch of baking soda into it. Okay, so first of all we have to take some vinegar and we have to add some baking soda. Now what do you observe? You may hear some hissing sound. Okay, and see bubbles coming out. So what do you observe? You will observe some hissing sound is there coming out from the mixture and you will see some bubbles. So this is carbon dioxide gas. Pass the gas through lime water and what do you observe, or what happens to the lime water? Now students, the result is that you will see that the lime water turns milky. Okay, we have discussed that carbon dioxide gas will form. Okay, and we add some water lime water. So what will happen? The lime water will turn milky. When carbon dioxide gas is passed through lime water, what will happen? Calcium carbonate is formed, okay, which turns the lime water milky. So this is also very important question, students. This is the reaction, that when carbon dioxide reacts with lime water means calcium hydroxide, CaOH hold 2, okay. So when carbon dioxide reacts with this CaOH hold 2, it will create calcium carbonate, CaCO3 plus water, okay. So for this calcium carbonate, this lime water turns into milky, okay. So we found that in activities 8.6, 8.7 and 8.8, all the three activities we have found that there are new substances formed. In 8.6, we have seen that magnesium, some white color ashes is formed, which we call it as magnesium oxide ashes. In activity 8.7, we have seen the reaction of copper sulfate with iron, produced iron sulfate and copper. Okay, so iron sulfate itself are new substance. Okay, and in the third case, similarly in activity 8.8, that means the last activity that we have discussed, carbon dioxide gas is produced in the reaction of vinegar and baking soda, and it reacted with lime water to form a new substance, which is calcium carbonate. Okay, so all the changes, students, the change in which a new substance is formed is called a chemical change. Okay, so chemical change is also called chemical reaction. Okay, now chemical changes are not reversible. Now students, we have already discussed that physical changes are reversible generally, but chemical changes are not reversible. Now students, tell me, if we have the same piece of paper, if we have this piece of paper and if I burn this piece of paper, then tell me that can we get back the piece of paper from the ashes? Definitely not possible, because it is a chemical change. Because whenever we burn something, that means it reacts with oxygen. Okay, that means it is a chemical change. So chemical change is not reversible, very important line. So few properties are there. Chemical changes are very, very useful for us, and they also occur inside our body. For example, digestion of food. Some other uses of chemical changes are as follows. So chemical changes are very important, such as metals are extracted from their ores through a chain of chemical changes. So metals can be extracted from their ores, okay, by using chemical changes. Medicines are prepared with the help of chemical changes. Plants produce their food through a chemical reaction known as photosynthesis. You might have learned these things in your biology part, that through photosynthesis plants can prepare their food. Plastics and detergents are also produced by chemical reactions. Okay, so these are the, you can say, uses of chemical reactions, and these are the answers that why we need chemical reactions, or why chemical reactions are so much important to our daily life. Okay, now the question arises, how do we know that a chemical change has taken place? So let us understand, okay, that if a change is taken place, then students, how do we know whether the change is chemical change or whether the change is a physical change? Okay, so students, there are few simple things that changes observed in chemical change. What are the things that we have to observe so that we can say that yes, this change is chemical change? Okay, so there are few things, few points are there by seeing that, or few characteristics are there by seeing that we can call it that yes, this change is chemical changes and this change is physical changes. Now students, physical changes we have discussed, that physical change, only physical properties will act. Physical property means you can say that shape, size, state, these are the physical properties. Okay, so when these things, when there is a change of shape, when there is a change of size, when there is a change of state, then we can call it that yes, this change is physical change. But a chemical change is usually accompanied by the following characteristics. Okay, that change in color, definitely color of copper sulfate solution changes from blue to green when an iron nail pull it. We have seen this in one activity. So definitely change of, when there is a change of color, we can say that yes, this change is a chemical change. Okay, release or absorption of heat or light. When there is a release or absorption of heat or light, that means heat and light is released on burning magnesium ribbon. We have also seen that when we burn magnesium ribbon, then heat and light will come. change in smell. When there is a change in smell, a foul smell is produced when food gets spoiled. Okay. Production of sound, definitely explosion of crackers, production of sound, these all are chemical changes and evolution of gas. Okay. When vinegar reacts with baking soda, carbon dioxide gas is produced. So, students, when these things are there in a reaction, so we can call it, or in a change, if these things are there, then if a change in color is there, if release or absorption of heat of light is there, if change in smell is there, if production of sound is there, and if evolution of gas is there, if these things are there, then we can call it that yes, this change is nothing but a chemical change and we can't reverse this change. Okay. This is a very important property, that chemical changes are irreversible. Okay. But physical changes are reversible. Okay. So this is the basic difference. Okay. Now let us discuss this process, that rusting of iron. Very important, and you have already read. What is rusting of iron? That rusting is a chemical change that affects the iron objects and slowly destroys them. Okay. In rusting, what will happen? A brown layer of oxide, you can say oxide iron, is formed on the surface of the objects due to the reaction of iron with oxygen and water. Okay. So this is the reaction. When we put a piece of iron into open weather, then it will react with oxygen and water and it will create rust iron or iron oxide, Fe2O3 dot n number of water. Okay. So for these things, for this iron oxide, this is nothing but the rust. Okay. Now iron is used to making bridges, ships, trucks, etc. Now due to this rusting, they become weak and lose strength. Now the process of rusting can be represented by the following equation. So this is the equation of rusting. Now students, tell me one thing, that iron is used widely. We made the bridge, made the ships, trucks using this iron. Now if it get rusted, then it will be a problematic situation for us. So there are some ways to prevent this rusting. So methods to prevent rusting. What are the methods? So few methods are there. We know that both air and water are needed for rusting to occur. So if we can, protect iron objects from air and moisture, so they will not get rusted. As simple as that. So some methods are there. Coating with paint. So on applying a coat of paint on iron objects, so they do not come in contact with air and moisture, hence rusting is prevented. So this is one process to prevent rusting, coating with paint. Coating with grease, definitely if we coat a grease like paint, also prevents iron objects from, you can say, coming direct contact with air and moisture, and it prevents it from rusting. This is very important, galvanization. What is the process? The process of depositing a layer of zinc on iron is called galvanization. Very important question, students. What do you mean by galvanization? The process of depositing a layer of zinc on iron is called galvanization. Okay. In this process, an iron object is coated with a layer of metal like chromium or zinc to prevent it from rusting. Okay. As simple as that. Next one is alloying. Some articles like utensils, or you can say some scissors and blades, are made of stainless steel. Now stainless steel is made by making some carbon and other metals like chromium, magnesium. Okay. So chromium, magnesium, and iron. Okay. So these things are there. So stainless steel is itself rust free. Okay. This process of mixing metals or non-metals is called alloying. Okay. So when two metals or non-metals are mixed with each other, so this process we can call it as alloying, and these are completely, you can say, rusting free. Okay. Okay. Now next thing is also very important, which we call it as crystallization. What is crystallization, students? Crystallization, this is very important part, that in class 6 we learned that many dissolved salts are present in seawater. Okay. Many dissolved salts are present in seawater. So these salts can be obtained by the evaporation of seawater. So when we evaporate the seawater, we can easily get the salt. So the salt, you can say, so obtained is in the form of very small crystals and is not pure. However, large crystals of pure salt can be obtained from seawater. So this process of obtaining pure and large crystals from seawater is called crystallization. So what is crystallization? Crystallization is nothing but the process of obtaining pure and large crystals from seawater is called crystallization. Okay, very simple as, okay, as simple as that. So students, I think this is the last portion of the chapter or last part of the chapter. So students, with this we have completed the chapter. Now what you have to do, you have to solve the exercise questions. Okay, in the online classes we will discuss once more. We will discuss the exercise questions also. So I hope students, you can correlate these things with your daily life. I hope you like the video. So students, that's all for today's video lecture. We will discuss, we will come with another video lecture of another chapter. So that's all students for this chapter. Thank you all and keep studying or keep reading.